benefit of students of distance learning. And the program at that time was development of e-contents. Now that association with EMRC Jodhpur continued and is continuing for the last 16 years. And during this period, I have produced more than 160 educational films for Consortium for Educational Communication, CEC, which is a body of UGC. And also, I have been awarded MOOC by UGC, and the same is also being run on the platform of EMRC Jodhpur. Friends, in this session, I'm going to discuss with you different aspects of MOOC, keeping in mind that some young research scholars are also there who probably may not have much idea about MOOCs. Then I'll start from the beginning and I'll take you through to the whole program by using my own personal experience as to how I have been developing these educational programs, what are the do's and don'ts, and how you can also be motivated and encouraged to do the same as to what I was doing. Later on, government started a program called NMEICT, that is National Mission for Education through Information and Communication Technology. And then later on, I can say 3-4 years ago, another prestigious program was launched, that is EPG Pathshala. And very recently, this MOOC became popular. So friends, I want to share a video with you. And through that video, I want to tell you that what all these terms are there, that is, what is distance learning, and what is your... flexible learning, what is online learning. So this small video will clear everything in a very short period.
Distance, online, and flexible learning. In today's busy and demanding world, adult learners are looking for more flexible ways to gain qualifications, increase their job prospects, and improve their earning potential. Gone are the days where students can afford to spend 20 or 30 hours per week in classroom. Advances in technology now allow students to access high-quality and engaging resources in their own home. Many students prefer to study their course without coming into class on a regular basis. This is commonly referred to as distance learning, but can also be called external, online, blended, or flexible learning. These terms are very similar and generally mean that there is little or no attendance on campus. Most learning materials are accessed through a website portal. Students will often have hard copy materials as well. Students will still have access to support via email and phone. Many students will attend tutorials for additional assistance. Flexible learning, also called blended learning, is a combination of class and distance and is where a student attends some online learning and some class-based learning. There are many reasons why students choose to study by distance. Classes are not held in the local area. Work commitments, family commitments, health reasons, a want of more flexible study times, time poor for various reasons, previous experience, meaning classes cover existing knowledge, alternative study programs or pathways, regular travel or hospital stays, existing worker completing a traineeship or RPL. Many courses have a work placement requirement, such as aged care and childcare, regardless of which mode of study selected. However, this is usually completed in the local area. Even though students are not attending classes, they are still able to access support services, including email and phone support, booking one-on-one tutoring, attending regularly held workshops, attending some classes subject to available places, orientation and engagement sessions early and throughout the course. The online portal is a structured learning pathway. This means that students work through activities and assessments in a structured manner. This structure is easy to follow and explained step by step. Each topic has instructions on how to complete that particular topic. Resources in the portal generally include learner guides for each topic, PowerPoint presentations, links to YouTube videos and websites, additional readings, toolboxes with videos and a range of activities, practice activities, free short courses such as work skills, literacy skills, and Microsoft Office, assessments and assessment tips and guides, lectures from your trainers.
So you have seen this particular video, which was there to introduce the basic terminology to you. Friends, my pedagogy in this particular lecture will be that I'll be sharing my PPTs and my experiences with you. Then I have brought two video clippings of my own. One was in the olden days, how we were shooting and recording these programs. And another one is relatively more recent. So that way I'll be able to tell you that how the technology has evolved over a period of time. And also I have requested the host to launch the poll after 12 o'clock. And we are going to have an open house question answer session towards the end of my lecture. I think that it is very, very important in this online mode that the speaker and the participants connect with each other. And so like it is in our childhood, there used to be a storyteller. Us storyteller ko hamesha ye puchna hota tha ki aap hunkara bharo. Yadi aap haan kar doge, hum kar doge, to wo aage badhega. So in this mode, the hunkara is your chat. So you can go on using your chat. You can raise your questions through the chat box, which the host can read out to me, selecting some of the questions. And some of the questions you can ask by raising hand and requesting the host to unmute you so that you can ask. I am looking forward to a very intense interaction towards the last half an hour or so, because that is where your doubts will be cleared and all. I think, friends, you will agree with me that academic networking plays a lot of role. It was a few months ago that I was invited to Central University of Rajasthan in near Ajmer for some faculty development program. And there two young faculty members from Babu Banarsidas Institute of Technology and Management, Lucknow, were the participants. And that time itself, during the tea break, as soon as my session was over, they made me promise that I'll come and visit their institute in Lucknow and deliver lecture for the benefit of their scholars and all. But like it is very rightly said by Priyanka, that courtesy corona, I'm sparing my visit to Lucknow by being in my own home, in my own home's library. I'm addressing you, and I'm able to address not only the students and faculty from Lucknow only, but from so many different places of the country. So let us make the full use of this particular session, which is going to be a very interesting one and a very practical one also. Friends, I request you to remember the spelling of learn, that is L-E-A-R-N. And if you remove L from here, what is left is earn. So a small message, but big spirit and idea behind it, that how much you will earn as much as you will be learning. And how you will learn by listening to me. And so this listen, L-I-S-T-E-N. Now there is a letter T, which is silent here. And there is a reason for that. When you are listening, you have to remain silent. That is why in the spelling of listen, there is a letter which is kept silent. So of course, silence they have maintained by muting the participants, but I am referring to the mental silence here. Mental silence in the sense that keeping your mind alert and alive and receptive for the ideas that I'm going to share with you. So friends, let's begin. And as I said that we are looking forward to great interactions. So I think that my screen is visible to all. Priyanka, you can let me know.
Yes, sir. It is visible.
Okay, fine. So this is about MOOCs, what, why, and how. And as I said that I'm aware here, some young research scholars and young assistant professors, faculty members are here. So I think that you are now exposed to MOOC from the point of view of the recipient, that you have been participating in many programs and many such courses and all. And so that now this lecture will also tell you about how to be on the other side of the person who is delivering these lectures to the participants. And so this is where we are going to start our presentation. Let me take you through to this timeline, and you will be surprised to know that it was only in the last 60 years that all these developments have taken place. And we started with computer-assisted instruction in the 1960s. Computer-based learning came in 1980s. Computer-mediated learning in 90s. Then e-learning in 1993. Open learning in 95. Virtual university in 1999. Learning management systems also in 99. Virtual campuses in 2000. And massive open online courses. That is what MOOCs stand for. They came in 2008. So friends, this is only a decade old concept. And as you know that in the time history of any subject, one decade is, you can say, a very tiny piece of sand on the sea beach. So MOOC was coined in 2008 by David Cormier of the University of Prince Edward Island. Though it was first introduced in 2006, but it was popularized in 2012. And basically MOOC emerged from the movement, which was very popular movement called OER. And this OER refers to open educational resources. So this open educational resources, that is OER, they gave rise to MOOCs. And these MOOCs provided basically interactive user forums to support community interactions among students, professors, and teaching assistants. So this became very popular in the last 8 years, we can say, from 2012 onwards. And in India, if I am not wrong, it became popular somewhere around after 2015 only. And when the government of India, MHRD, included MOOC in their policy framework and they started laying emphasis on it. And among the general population and general public and our academic fraternity, this MOOC became popular only during the lockdown period. So we can say that March 2020 onwards, that the many of the young participants here have become exposed to this MOOC. And I can look at it as kind of a disruption here, right? So this disruptive technology of MOOC, that is what we are going to discuss here. Massive stands for large enrollment numbers. Massive, that is, it is just the same as what you call in distance learning. We can have as many as the students admitted. Open means that there has to be some flexibility with regard to the qualifications and eligibility and all, because there have been certain MOOCs which are non-credit and you can just join them as per your own interest and as per your own requirements also. Online, this is purely online delivery course. So that is why, and the course it is called because it is a well-structured one. So it is an online course aimed at unlimited participation and open access via the web. I think the this basic philosophy of MOOC is best encapsulated by these three A's, that is anytime, anyone, anywhere. And so friends, this was a brief idea about what is MOOC. Now, as far as why is concerned, we all know that this has come to revolutionize the field of education in general and online education in particular. And so, like the way we could not avoid computerized network, ATMs, or any such disruptions. Similarly, I look at MOOC as a major disruption in our field of higher education. And that is where I think that you will agree with me that these MOOCs are going to stay with us for a long, long period of time. Friends, there are some key players in the gamut of MOOCs. The role of teachers is to create content, create course, define course. We are talking about MOOC course basically. Start course, assist learners, and exam preparation. So these would be the responsibilities of the teachers in the MOOC format. As far as the learners are concerned, the learner has to enroll for the course, study the course, wherever necessary, interact with teacher, appear in exam, get certificate oblique credit. And this is optional, as I can say, that some of the MOOC courses which are non-credit in nature, you may not be required to appear in exam, and therefore you may not be able to claim any certificate for that and all. But what I am trying to tell you here is that in our country, with the learners, they have a special interest for going through till the end and obtain the certificate by clearing the exam. So this is a major feature of Indian learners, which makes them different from the overseas learners. In many cases, those overseas learners just join the course for improving their skills or getting knowledge of the desired field only. Friends, continuing with the key players, we have got many things also important, like some platform has to be there for delivering our courses. And as far as the Indian education, higher education ecosystem is concerned, it is called SWIM. In the latter part of my lecture, we are going to talk more about SWIM. This is a MOOC platform developed by MHRD, and all subject domains are covered. The courses from school to university, because this SWIM platform is also available to the school students as well. Certificate or credit is also allowed. This is as per the regulatory bodies such as UGC and all. The major players here are UGC, that is University Grants Commission, New Delhi, CEC, that is Consortium for Educational Communication, which is an associate body of UGC. Actually, it was on this platform of CEC that I have made maximum of my films. I think somewhere around 160 so far I have done. Indira Gandhi National Open University, NPTEL, last two, NCERT and NIOS, National Institute of Open School. These two last two are for school education purposes. Above ones are for the higher education purposes. Now we come to a very aspect of what are the tips for designing a MOOC, which happens to be the crux of my lecture today, that is how to develop a MOOC program. So friends, even though you may be a young faculty member and you may not have so far developed a MOOC program, but I visualize you taking lead, and in due course of time, let's say in another 4 or 5 years of time, I want you to flourish as a physician, and maybe you may be involved in developing your own MOOC program. So this gestation period you can take as a preparation time for developing mastery in this field, because it is not very easy to develop a MOOC program. And let me also tell you that it is not very easy for me to teach you how to develop a MOOC program in, let us say, 45 minutes or 1 hour or whatever. But what I am trying to share with you is based on my own experience. First and foremost, if you want to develop a MOOC program of your own, then you must participate in at least one MOOC program. That way, you will be able to develop empathy. That way, you will be able to see the nitty-gritties of a MOOC program. And also, try to read about the experiences and approaches of other faculty members who have taught MOOCs. That is where people like me come in. I'm prepared to mentor anyone present here in this program. If they want to approach me through my email, then I can provide them mentorship. And I'm already doing that in my university and in my academic circle. And I'm encouraging them and guiding them to develop their own MOOC programs. And I'm glad that in few such cases, some faculty members have been awarded MOOC programs by UGC. Now choose a topic you are passionate about and one that will be appealing to
So you're not audible, there's some issue with the connectivity.
Now this is a very interesting aspect here, which are relatively tough and which are relatively not picked up by other faculty members. Why? Because UGC and CEC, they receive large number of proposals from academicians from all parts of the country, and programs, when you are developing this MOOC, then you will have to understand that what will be the targeted audience, and also you have to design the course to meet the needs of that audience. So when you are developing those, selecting those programs, those courses, which others have not taken, then chances of a MOOC being allotted to you increases. And you will have to search the aspects of what you call some model curriculum by UGC. And you have to also see to it that you are...
Sir, from your side, there is a connectivity issue, sir. Please recheck.
Okay. So I have to reshare again? Stop sharing?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
I'll do that. Just a minute. Now,
sir, text are not visible properly. Might be due to some network connectivity.
The PowerPoint is not visible.
Sir, only the bullet that the bold points are visible, but somewhat like.
Okay. The text is
bold in between. Yes, sir. Yes.
Okay. Now, in all these slides.
So the text is not properly visible. It is a bit blurred.
Yes, sir.
Okay, it is blurred.
Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
So give me a minute. I'll check the internet connection and we'll get back to you quickly.
Yes, sir.
In the chat box, though we have disabled yes. the chatting publicly, but we will receive the messages. We will be enabling the public chatting towards the end of the session when the
that you are submitting to UGC through their academic bodies and final approval from academic council. This is required for credit transfer purposes. And this is where the UGC guidelines are also given to the universities that they have to promote MOOCs. And then this will not be a problem once that UGC circular is also attached with your proposal to the university. In the next stage, you have to identify one agency for recording your programs, because you will require a proper video recording facility, editing facility, post-production, and all those facilities are required. So I don't advise you to go to any novice team or any such private players who are doing this work without any particular kind of expertise or what. My suggestion to you is that you can approach the nearest EMRC, because CEC has established more than 30 EMRC in the country. And so I'm sure that Lucknow may be having one EMRC. In Rajasthan, it is in Jodhpur. So if you approach that EMRC, then they can help you with the recording and all. And of course, the amount of money that you are receiving, you will have to pay for these facilities to them. So that way you can proceed. Now, one more advice that I want to give you, and which is there on the slide also, is that don't attempt this MOOC single-handedly. Try to develop a team, because there will be one PI, principal investigator, like any project is there, but then you can have co-investigator, you can have some assistants and all. So develop a team of the passionate and enthusiastic colleagues, and this team will help you in all the stages of developing, designing, and delivering MOOC also. And so I'll discuss more about this team later on. You will have to also plan the development process, in the sense that the course has to be divided into video tutorials, then how you are going to go ahead with it. And of course, first and foremost will be that you have to have approval from any of these national coordinating bodies. I'll be sharing with you the details of that also in my presentation very soon. So you have to also establish learning outcomes for the course before we begin selecting or creating materials. You know very well that nowadays this learning outcome curriculum framework, LOCF, objective-based learning, that have become outcome-based learning, that have become very important nowadays. And so you have to develop that also beforehand. We have to also design our communication plan and community development strategies also. Communication plans means how many videos will be there. Even there can be some audios also, right? And then you have to also develop assessment strategy, that how you will be assessing for examination and all those things. Here again, this is basically the classification basis. I have wrongly given the heading as key players. This is classification basis. The MOOC courses can either be paid or free. As far as the SWAYAM courses are concerned, they are free as long as you don't appear in exam and don't ask for certificate. If you want to appear in exam and if you want to get the certificate, then fees has to be paid for that part. Because you should understand that the agencies which are hosting this course, they will have to spend money on arranging for exam and arranging your assessment evaluation and then giving you certificate and all those things. Similarly, the PACE. Now this slide is visible, Priyanka?
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. Now PACE could be either schedule driven or it could be self-paced. Mostly in our country, the MOOC courses which are run on SWAYAM platforms, they are schedule driven. And so schedule driven, that way they have a starting date which is decided by the host, and then ending date also decided by the host. As far as self-paced programs are concerned, the duration is mentioned, let us say 6 weeks duration. And self-paced means whenever you choose to start. Suppose you are starting on 11th June, then 6 weeks from now, let us say that 26th July, it will end automatically. So that way, self-paced is when the different learner is entering at different stages in the program, and schedule driven is where the bulk, the group of participants are joining together and moving out together. Instructors could also be the university teachers and university courses that can be offered, or it could be also the private firms. There are many private players like Coursera and all edX, etc., which are very active in this field of MOOC courses. Now, let us come to this particular slide here, where the major platforms we are talking about. And this major platform, one is edX, then Course Builder, Coursera, Moodle, Udacity, and Swyam. As I said, that Swyam is something which is very relevant for Indian ecosystem, because this is launched by our own MHRD, Ministry of Human Resource Development, Government of India. When you are searching for some technical support, then I wanted to show this slide to you that it has to be a very professional kind of a setup, because the camera has to be very good, the production, post-production editing tables have to be really good. It's not only the equipment, lighting also. I remember the initial days of my recording in 2005-06 and all. That time the lights were so hot that I used to perspire a lot. Now in last 3-4 years, we have been using LED lighting, LED lighting. And then this LED lighting is very soothing. So this kind of technical details also you must keep in mind while developing MOOC, because the quality of the MOOC has to be better. So this is where I think that I want to share with you that some nowadays the virtual this thing platforms and virtual softwares are also there, which can give you a different shape of your presentation. I'll be sharing with you two video clippings, one of my old lecture, which was recorded somewhere around 2006, and a relatively recent lecture, which was recorded somewhere around 2018. So gap of 12 years was there, and then you will be able to see the difference in technology and all in that particular lecture. Moving further, I thought that I'll be sharing some thoughts with you regarding your SWIM. As you know that it is an acronym for Study Webs of Active Learning for Young Aspiring Minds. That would be SWIM is a program initiated by Government of India. It is basically an all Indian open source platform, and all the courses are highly interactive and prepared by the best of the teachers in the country. The SWIM platform, as I told you earlier, was that it is also available for school education and vocational training as well. And it is free of cost to the residents in India. And free of cost to the extent that if you are not going for exam and certification. If you are going for exam and certification, then it will be a different story. You will have to pay a nominal fees. But remember that the government's objective is not to make any kind of profit out of it, but to popularize the education in our masses. So large scale national rollout has already been done now. This is very interesting for you to understand that these MOOC courses, whether it is hosted on SWIM or any platform, all these MOOC courses must be having 4 quadrants. And these quadrants have little bit variation when it comes from one platform to another. But then on SWIM platform, these 4 quadrants are, first one will be the video lecture. As I said, if you want to share audio clippings, audio lectures, that also is allowed. But I feel that video lectures are more effective. Secondly, you have to have a specially prepared reading material that you have to made available to the learners, which learners can download, and if necessary, they can get it printed. There has to be some quizzes, some self-assessment tests through various small quizzes and internal tests or those kind of things. Fourth is very important, and that is where I feel that SWIM is not coming up to my expectations, is that there has to be an online discussion forum for clearing the doubts of the learners. So that is why I was telling you that it is better to have a team with you, so that some of these team members, the teaching assistants, you can say, they can handle this self-assessment quiz part and so on, evaluation of quiz and making you updated with the progress of the learners and all. They can also act as the helpline or help center to the learners, participants, who may not have direct access to the senior teacher of PI, but they can approach the teaching assistant and they can pass on some of the doubts which these teaching assistants could not clear, and they can get it answered by the senior professor, and the learners' doubts can be clarified. Online discussion forum, personally, I would suggest that the senior teacher has to be available for interaction with the students. So that is why a full team is required here for developing MOOCs. Once again, I'll skip some of these things, because I would again reinforce on these four quadrants. The first quadrant is regarding e-tutorial, as I said, audio-video lectures. The second quadrant is e-content, that is where you your transcript of your audio-video can be there. Apart from that, there can be other additional reading material, web resources, and even the links of other relevant literature can be given. The term that I was sharing with you, open educational resources, OER, that can be used here. As a teacher who has to develop a MOOC, I would strongly suggest that you go through a MOOC on OER. That is how to use OER, right? Because that way you will be saving a lot on your labor and effort later on. Quadrant three is self-assessment, as I have already told. Quadrant four is online discussion forum and all. I'll be sharing with you the national coordinators which are there for SWIM. And here it will be very interesting for you to know that All India Council for Technical Education, New Delhi, has been assigned the responsibility of self-paced courses. Now, as I was telling you that these will not be the scheduled courses, but self-paced courses. And I have seen the list of these courses. Most of them are skill-oriented courses. Now, NPTEL is offering courses for engineering disciplines. UGC has been entrusted with the postgraduate education. And I was telling you that few years ago, UGC has started EPG Pathshala program. And now they are they have come out to this MOOC program. So what UGC and these relevant national coordinators, what they are doing is that they are repurposing the content which was developed for EPG Pathshala. And repurposing means now the MOOC format is different. And so the basic videos and those tutorials are picked up from EPG Pathshala, and then now they are reframing them to suit the MOOC format. CEC is the body entrusted for undergraduate education. As I told that this is Consortium for Educational Communication. It is an associate body of the UGC, and all the undergraduate courses, whether it is BSc, BBA, BCom, vocational courses, BA vocational, BBA, whatever, all these UG courses, except those engineering for which NPTEL is there. So these UG courses are offered by CEC. I am sure that if you visit their website, you will be able to know what kind of courses they are having the mandate to offer. And you can select from their list of courses any particular course that you want to develop for MOOC. NCERT and NIOS, NIOS basically National Institute for Open Schooling, is meant for school education. IGNOU, as we know very well, has the mandate for distance learners. So out of the school students, that means that higher education, those who have done 12th and now they want to do their graduation or any distance learning course. So IGNOU has the mandate for that. Indian Institute of Management Bangalore has been entrusted with the management studies courses. So these are some of the national coordinators here. Of course, MOOC is not free from limitations, and I'm sure that this is also having some certain amount of limitations. We know very well there has been large number of surveys which were conducted during this lockdown, and all students and faculty members both participated in these surveys. And in maximum cases, majority of the cases, we found that these surveys are not actually, these surveys are highlighting the fact that students and faculty members find this online medium not at par with the classroom face-to-face education, but we are stuck with it. And if I may say that it is the second best forum available to us. At this juncture, I also want to share with you that MHRD has developed, has identified 72 educational institutions as NRCs, National Resource Centers. And each resource center has been given the responsibility of developing the MOOC programs. These are called ARPIT. ARPIT is Annual Refresher Program in Teaching. So these ARPIT programs, which are of 2 weeks duration, they have been given the equivalence of the refresher course that a teacher has to do in order to progress in his or her career. And so whenever as a student or as a learner, whenever you are joining any such program, you must keep in mind that it is an authentic MOOC program. It is offered by accredited agency, like these NRCs are accredited. They are recognized by MHRD and UGC to offer such programs. Similarly, we have Pandit Madan Mohan Malviya Mission for Education. So that those programs of faculty development program, faculty induction programs of 1 week, 3 week, 1 month, 3 weeks duration and all, they are all accredited. So be very careful when you are choosing such program, because if you have to get this equivalence of refresher or orientation or whatever, then these accredited agencies are only allowed to give certificate which is equivalent. And these certificate also you will not be given just for participating, but your active learning throughout the program and participation in the different quizzes, your regular attendance, and finally clearing the exam with proper grades and all that, subject to all these conditions being fulfilled, you will be given the certificate and all. So friends, I think that we must believe in learning. I started with learn and removed L from that to come to earn. And so I'm ending with, again, we believe in learning, all kinds of learning for all kinds of people, delivered in a personal style, because wherever learning flourishes, so do people. So I think that this particular slide, what I was sharing with you, I am stopping the this thing. So this was my brief presentation on MOOCs. Probably you have got some idea about what, why, and how of MOOC. And I tried to particularly focus on how to develop a MOOC. And that too also I was telling you that you have to work really hard if you have to develop this kind of MOOC programs. I want to share with you one or two more videos, and then we will be open for our discussion and all. And I would be requesting the host to launch the poll questions also, side by side.
Yes, sir.
And this video you are able to see?
Yes, sir. Sir, please increase the volume of your video.
That supports your business from the ground up. Unfortunately, avoiding add-ons or piecemeal solutions is challenging.
That leads us to the second secret.
Okay.
Sir, it's not audible.
Okay.
Sir, kindly replay.
You are not able to listen to it?
Yes, sir.
Okay, let me try again.
The first secret to implementing a successful e-learning strategy is... The first secret to implementing a successful e-learning strategy is to forget about e-learning and start with your business requirements. Too often, e-learning solutions are built as add-ons that are ignored or ineffective. Starting with your business strategy, vision, and goals will ensure that your e-learning solution is integrated into and supports your business from the ground up. Unfortunately, avoiding add-ons or piecemeal solutions is challenging because the market is full of them. They're easy to spot because they tend to talk about learning management systems over here and SCORM content over there. That leads us to the second secret, which is to create an integrated learning environment, which combines platform and content for a powerful, seamless learner experience. Ideally, this solution would have the convenience and benefits of a cloud delivery and could even map pathways to diploma or degree accreditation. Sounds great so far, but you're on a budget, and creating quality tailored content can cost a fortune. That's why the third secret is to be smart and strategic about content. This involves using savvy instructional design to target high priority goals with engaging scenario-based activities. Implementing a content curation strategy rather than building everything from scratch. And supplementing that with a rapid e-learning approach to create strong, rich content where it's most needed. The final secret is that formal learning is only a small part of the picture. We suggest you use the 70-20-10 model, which identifies that about 70% of learning happens through on-the-job experience, 20% happens with the help of other people, and only 10% occurs formally. Choose an e-learning provider who embraces this and whose solutions support informal, social, and blended learning.
Then one more I want to show here.
Let us take, his name is Ram. Who is able to serve?
Is the video visible?
Yes, sir.
Okay, this is what I was telling, that around 2006 I recorded this video, and as you can see, the technology is old here, and I'm using the blackboard here with the conventional chalk and talk thing. Only thing is that I was given the space on the blackboard that I have to remain within this boundaries only, and so just 1 minute clipping for this.
with 3 customer per hour. He is charging a daily wages of 7 rupees. Hourly wages rather. His hourly wages are 7 rupees per hour. Is charging a daily wages of 7 rupees. His hourly wages per hour. Even this cost of customer dissatisfaction is satisfaction cost will be rupees. Can find out the total cost of providing services. Plus cost of providing services. One by one.
There is the last one.
Okay.
European country.
This is what I was telling you that it was, I faintly remember that it was recorded in 2018. Now the technology has completely the anchor with giving the news, the desk, all that which you are seeing is actually physically not there. I was using a very simple table for this, but then the software was used to give this kind of look in the final video. And so let me share one. Clipping
trees, but all of them have come together on part of sovereignty to become member of the European Union. It is a unique institution where the member countries voluntarily cede their national sovereignty in many areas to carry out common policies and governance. One very a strong example that can be given here is that currency called euro.
This was the one. Fine. Now this is all I wanted to
do.
Questions to me from
sir,
your yes.
Sir, first we go with the poll, with your permission.
Okay.
Sir.
Yes, sure. You can go ahead.
Divyanshu, please launch poll 1. Divyansh.
Fine, so it is quite obvious that 95% of this also shows you have been listening to this very clearly.
Divyanshu, launch poll 2.
Now next question can be launched.
Yes, sir.
No, shall we share the results? Yes, please. Okay, this is this result is also understandable because machine learning. But yes, 79% of the participants have given the right answer that it is hybrid. So blended learning is going to be the future, let me tell you. And in the conventional classroom, even after the corona pandemic is over and we return to our classes and we find our students
if you have any question, you can raise your hand. Okay, we have Professor Sapan Sthana.
Yes, Sapanji, go ahead.
Sir, we you can unmute yourself.
Very nice. Good afternoon, sir. Wonderful, sir, lecture delivered by you, sir. And today is the new era of the education, and the massive open online education is really played a very important role. The question, one my very small question, sir. Everybody is asking. In earlier we never prepared e-content or MOOC courses, and now we just go to start. Then, sir, what is your message for young faculty members? To immediately start the massive MOOC courses, because sir, UGC also saying around 35 to 40% courses will be run online, sir. Sir, how will you start? Correct. Because a lot of the fear in mind, because sir, you are the senior professor, and sir, you are preparing such type of the courses. But sir, suppose many faculty, new faculty members, young faculty still not prepared any MOOC courses, sir, then how they will start, sir?
Yes, very nice. And thank you for the compliment, Sapanji. And a very relevant question that you have asked, and I think that you have represented the voice of all the participants here, because it is definitely very scary to begin. And if I am allowed, I can share my own experience with you. That first time when I came in front of the camera, and I was telling you that it was 1996 when I was working for IGNOU. first time I came in front of the camera, I was shaking like this. I was trembling, and to avoid my hands being seen, I had put my hands under the table. And within but few minutes only, 3-4 minutes afterwards, I found that I am settled. So my suggestion is that you cannot learn swimming by reading about it. You have to one day decide to jump into the water, but don't jump into the water without preparation. So preparation is the key. As I said, that you join a MOOC, see how these resource persons are acting and behaving and doing their work, then do some what you can call prepare your subject thoroughly, then prepare the PPT, then face the camera, do some mock recordings, and sit with the technical persons, producer and all, and discuss with them, because I have learned a lot from my producers and from my cameramen. And so that is how I think you can go ahead in your preparation. And one, I cannot promise you that you will be fearless in your first attempt itself. You may be quite afraid in the beginning, but once you make the beginning, once you put your step forward, and once you develop experience, then I think that definitely you will emerge successful. And as I have said earlier, and I'm offering my services again, that anybody who wants to do the come forward in this manner, then I'm prepared to become their mentor.
Thank you, sir.
Yes, next question.
Thank you for answering it in such a nice way. We have Professor Dr. Manisha Shukla, ma'am. She has raised the hand. Just a second. Yes, Manisha, ma'am, you can now unmute yourself and ask the question directly from sir.
Right. Thank you so much, Professor. You gave a very good insight into the MOOC system and the MOOC courses. Now, what I really want to ask you is, are there agencies, the funding agencies, which support you financially also for designing and forming these courses?
Yes, thank you that you like my lecture. Manisha, I think I got your name as Manisha ji. Is that right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yes, definitely funding is provided. And you will be glad to learn that the extent of funding is in excess of 5 lakhs rupees. But only thing is that your proposal has to come up to the expectations of the screening committee. And once you have crossed that screening stage, and UGC, if they have shortlisted your proposal, or any of those national coordinator agencies, what I was telling, then you will be given financial assistance. Of course, out of this 5 lakh rupees, you will have to pay substantial amount of money to the technical people who are preparing the videos, post-production, editing and all. But still, as a resource person, I'm sure that you will be getting somewhere around 2 lakhs rupees as your own stadium or compensation. If you have a team, then you can divide this amount among yourself. Why I'm telling you that roughly 30 to 40 videos lectures are prepared, and normally 5,000 rupees is the honorarium for per video. And so based on that, I have calculated to around 2 lakh rupees. That will be your honorarium. And you can share it with your other team members if they are making videos along with you. Similarly, you can have some young teaching assistants also associated with you, because the video or audio that you are preparing, they will be transcribed. And so this transcription can be done by our young research scholars or anybody. And 500 rupees per movie of 25 to 30 minutes, that 500 rupees is payable to even that young research scholar who is doing the transcripting. So that way, financial part is this. But I look at the incentivization in terms of the larger thing. Larger thing is that, and friends, there's 160 participants who are very carefully listening to me. I'm thankful to them for that. That apart from money, you get API scores. And you will not believe that this new UGC API regulations of 18th July 2018, they have included your MOOC programs as a very important component for giving API marks. So I was telling you that there are four quadrants in MOOC courses. And so you will see that for each quadrant, you earn separate API scores. And I cannot tell you off the hand what is that, but I remember at least minimum 5 marks are there per quadrant. Right now, please listen to me carefully. There is a course, 40 films are there. Each film has 4 quadrants. And so 40 into 4, 160. And suppose 5 marks average you are getting. So from one MOOC course, you can get 800 marks. And even if you are having a team, then you can share with them, but PI will end up getting more than 500 marks or so. From one MOOC program of, let us say, I was awarded this course on business statistics, right? So then in this, this is the situation with regard to financial incentives and with regard to API incentives also. Very good question. Thank you. We are ready for next.
Thank you, sir. We have so many queries popping up in the chat box. We'll just take a few of them.
I think that you can accommodate most of them. It will be beneficial for them.
Yes,
if your protocol allows this.
Yes, sir. We will.
Okay.
And Professor Devrati Dev.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Professor Devrati Dev, she says a very informative and awakening session indeed. I want to ask that what is the qualification required to be eligible to design MOOC?
Okay. Qualification wise, I would say that even if you are an assistant professor level academic, then also you are eligible. Only thing is that I think we want to reinforce here, because it is the government funding. So then your institution should be having 2F-12B status from UGC, which means that all the central universities, all the state universities, all the UGC-financed deemed universities, and apart from that, all those autonomous institutions which are under 2F and 12B will be eligible to receive funding under this particular scheme.
Okay, thank you, sir. But
I don't want to discourage my young friends who are coming from private institutions here, because even if you are not able to get funding from UGC, MHRD and all, my suggestion to you is that this particular market has opened up in a big way, and you can approach private players like Coursera, like edX, and there are Udacity and many. I think they are also looking for very good quality resource persons, and you can approach them, you can work out the financials with them. Of course, probably you will not get the API score and all, but then you will have the satisfaction of developing and launching your own MOOC program. Thank you.
Next. Thank you, sir, for answering the question in such a nice way. We'll be taking next question. We have, there are so many compliments that we are getting, and excellent and informative session. And then Professor Ritu Bharti says, sir, how can we access and measure the effectiveness of online learning or of MOOCs courses?
This is a very tricky question, madam, because of the fact that the methodology, the whole branch of MOOC is still in its nascent stages. And so the particular kind of what you can call the effectiveness and all will require some time for any mechanism to develop. But then MOOC basically has been designed in such a manner that they are building in some assignments, some quizzes, some practical exercises, some self-assessment questions, some examination and all, and then monitoring the progress of the learners throughout the course of the program, then we can go for we can see that the learners have been effectively using this particular course or not. So I think that this part it will take further more time to be developed, but then in the meantime we have to rely on how the learners are responding. And believe me that when you are making your videos and all, don't think that you are addressing a cameraman. Think that you are addressing a student or a group of students before you. I remember a very interesting incident that when I was in IGNOU and I was doing this teleconferencing and all, and so I saw that this group of cameramen, they were not paying attention to me. And so I told them that you have to pay attention to me. They did not listen to me. So then I approached the director EMRC, a very prominent lady was there in the field of multimedia. I'm forgetting her name. But then she laughed at me. She said, why you want their attention? I said, I look upon them as my students only, and I don't allow my students to be distracted. And so that is how you have to get involved in this medium. Later on, when I was doing recording of my programs at EMRC Jodhpur, you will be glad to learn that few of the cameramen and electrician and technician involved in the preparation of my programs, they were encouraged to join some online MBA programs from Symbiosis and other institutions. They obtained their MBA degree, and some of them are working in very prestigious institutions, even FTII and all, Pune and all. So what I'm telling that a teacher, if he is doing his course in an interesting manner, the fountainhead is teacher. If he does it well, then definitely learner will also be involved and effectiveness will come. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. We have now Professor Dr. Akanshi Gupta with us. She has raised her hand. Ma'am, you can unmute yourself. We have enabled the setting and you can ask the question. Professor Dr. Akanshi Gupta, ma'am, are you there? Okay, in the meanwhile, we'll take the questions that are there in the chat box.
Yes, sure.
Sir, participants are complimenting your session. Valuable information by Dr. Kabanesh Saxena, sir. It was a wonderful session. It was wonderful and informative session by sir. Nice session, sir. Nice session, really. Nice session, sir. Regards, Amit.
Priyanka, I'm more interested in any critical comment to improve it further for future audiences.
There are so many compliments. I have to search that which one is the question. Sir, could you please suggest few more courses for faculty members and MBA students?
Okay, this is coming from Vipin Chaudhary, Indore.
Yes, sir.
Okay, I could see in the chat box, and out of so many of the participants present here, I have privilege and honor to be very closely associated with many of them, and Vipin is one such academician from Indore. So there are you will have to approach IIM Bangalore, Vipin, because they have been the national coordinator for management courses and MBA courses particularly. But if you are interested in management courses at the UG level, then you will have to approach CEC. And here also, as I was telling, that if you can take up some unusual courses and some new generation courses, like such as digital marketing or social media marketing or retail marketing, or in case of your this thing in banking, again some aspects of IT in banking and those. So those courses which are relatively more de novo kind of courses or innovative kind of courses, so that will give you more satisfaction, and that will also increase your chances of your proposal being accepted by them. Because let me tell you that once you submit the proposal, that whichever national coordinator agency is there, they have a team of very senior academics, and so senior that again, if I am allowed, I can share one more experience with you people. And it is actually a very proud moment for me. It was most of the programs that I was preparing under EMRC banner, they were going to CEC, and CEC was having their own team too. Each and every video that we prepare has to go to the team of experts, and they review it first, And once they have reviewed and they found it okay, then they allowed it to proceed further. And so one of my reviewer there was Professor Furqan Qamar sir. And he was a professor in Jamia at that time. I am talking about 13, 14 years ago. Later on, he became professor, vice chancellor in Rajasthan University, Jaipur. I happened to visit Rajasthan University, Jaipur, and then I was pleasantly surprised when he invited me to his home for a cup of tea. And I requested him that, sir, he told me that I know you very well. So I was surprised. I said, I have never met you, sir. He said, I have reviewed at least 30, 40 of your educational videos. So that way, a kind of a bond was developed between the two of us. So what I am telling you is that whatever work you are doing has to be of good quality. The programs you can identify by contacting the appropriate national coordinator. Go visit their website, see what the
current... Sir, you are not audible.
What value addition you can do.
Okay. But just a minute.
Now am I audible or
yes sir now audible sir.
So let us take the next question.
Yes sir. Professor Anuja Dhyani says, good afternoon sir, is there a limit on the number of participants in MOOC, and if no, then how can a teacher manage an unlimited number of students?
Let me tell you that the answer to this question, I am not very clear about it. Reason being that when this Arpit 1 was launched by NRC management, I was telling you about NRC's National Resource Centers that MHRD has identified 72 bodies. For the subject of management, they have identified Banisthali Vidyapeeth, which is in Rajasthan itself. And I was in their national academic body. In the first module, in the first season of the program, we developed 40 modules and we delivered. That time I remember somewhere around 2,500 plus participants were there. And next module, when it was launched last year in May, June, that time, I think I was told that more than 5,000 participants had joined the program. But I do not know, because I was only their academic advisory body member, and I have developed two modules in the first season and one module in the second season. But how they were managing and how they were arranging for the quiz and examination and all, sorry, I don't have first-hand idea about that. But figures, numbers I am giving you, to give you an idea that they have managed this larger number. Of course, in the second installment, some of the participants were complaining to me, yes, sir, we are asked, okay, or 330 is okay, or whatever. But yes, there has to be a reasonable amount of number, then only it can work in a nice manner. But I don't know that number. But it's a good question and it has given me some food for thought for future. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. We'll take next question. Professor Dr. Nishita Pankan says, I guess she's from Kerala. Sir, it was informative session. MOOC will be the future of higher education. Sir, what is your take on this? So many students are doing MOOC courses such as Coursera. I guess, Professor Dr. Nishita, kindly confirm, is it Coursera?
Coursera, yeah.
What is the credibility of course like Coursera in having employees? I'll repeat the question. It was informative.
Idea that if it is a MHRD UGC course, then universities have the binding to include in their course curriculum and approve it from their academic council. And so far, so much that a credit transfer is possible. Now, credit transfer is what? That suppose I am a student of BCom second year. Now, I have to appear in first semester 6 papers. One paper of business statistics, I choose not to go into the face-to-face class. And I inform my university and administration, taking the permission from them, that I want to attend the MOOC course on business statistics developed by Professor Karunesh Saxena, which is approved by UGC. And because the university has already passed in their academic council, they will allow the student, he will come and join my MOOC program, complete all the formalities, receive a certificate from me. He will submit that certificate in the university, and university will incorporate this grade and marks in their own mark sheet and all. And that way the whole system will work. So I was telling you about this SWIM platform and UGC MHRD recognized and accredited programs and all. As far as Coursera is concerned, madam, I would not say that these courses are inferior in any manner. They have their own virtues, their own values. Some of them short-term courses are there. Some of them skill development courses are there. And I think that these courses may not have this kind of credit transfer recognition. But then I am sure that the employers of our country are recognizing these bodies, and they are flourishing in our country. Yesterday, I was having the honor on behalf of my vice-chancellor, who was busy in some other meetings. He nominated me to attend a vice-chancellor's or from any private agency like Coursera and all. Madam, I think I have answered.
Thank you, sir. And then we have from Professor Rajiv Chand Sharma, is there any opportunity to prepare MOOCs for retired or going to retire in near future?
Yes, sir. I salute you as my senior, Professor Sharma, and I want to tell you that yes, even if you are going to retire or a retired academician, it will not make any difference in your qualification for getting the MOOC. Only thing, you have to follow the process what I was telling, and your MOOC proposal has to be of that quality that you can be awarded that. The retired persons are being called for recording and all. I have seen in EMRC Jodhpur and all. And nowadays, they are asking for 5-minute recording along with your proposal also. So be sure to give your best recording of 5 minutes so that your chances of getting a MOOC increases. Retired people are also welcome. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, sir. Now we have another question with us.
Yes, please.
Yes, sir.
Priyanka?
Yes, sir.
I saw in the chat there was a question from Amit Mishra. If you can read it out to me.
I'll just find that chat, sir. Just give me a second.
Or unmute him, he can ask.
Yeah, we will. I'll just read out the text as well.
Whatever manner.
Yes, sir. Professor Dr. Amit Mishra says, very, very nice and informative session, sir. I want to ask a question, that is, MOOC is useful in doing research in film management process?
There are all kinds of MOOCs, because this is a world where unlimited possibilities are there. And I think if you search carefully, then on Coursera or Udacity or edX, these platforms, you can find the course that you are looking for. If even if the same course may not be there, but then you can find some peripheral courses like a MOOC program on editing, a MOOC program on animation, a MOOC program on script writing, cinematography, and things like that. So I'm sure that you can search for the program of your interest and you can enroll and do it. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. We have one more question from Professor Manish Kumar. It was really a wonderful experience to participate. He is complimenting you, your session, sir. And then all the compliments we have. Professor Dr. Subhash Chandra says, sir, is any university in North India which recognize such courses for credit transfers?
Yes, I can give the examples of two of the universities. One is Jain Vyas University, Jodhpur, and other is my own university, Mohanlal Sukhade University, Udaipur. Because this happens to be one of the basic preconditions for you to apply for MOOC and to get the MOOC program awarded by the funding agency. And there may be many. The Delhi University has pioneered. They were the coordinators for EPG Pathshala. I remember there was a team of dedicated persons working in the Department of Commerce there. And so I'm sure that Delhi University must have also made provisions. But I cannot tell you about how many universities are there and all. You will have to approach individual. If you have any particular university in mind, you can approach them and then you can get the inquiries from them. But then because the government mandate is that they have created a SWIM platform, and believe me that whatever fees they are charging, either they are not charging any fees or very negligible fees they are charging, but they have pumped in crores of rupees into this MOOC program. And also government also wants this MOOC to be successful. And they know that it will be successful only when the credit transfer is allowed by the university. So even if now it is not there, but in future, many universities will have to fall in the line and give credit transfer to them. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Dear participants, if you would like to make use of this opportunity of asking your question directly from sir, you can raise your hand. Sir, shall I take another question from chat box?
Yes, sure. And I would prefer if the participants want to ask directly, I would prefer that also. But in the meantime, if somebody is not ready, you can ask me from the chat.
Okay, sir. We have Professor Ashish Mathur with us. He says, very useful, informative, and important session for us as young teachers. One question is, can MOOC lectures for CEC or UGC be recorded only with EMMRC or with some other agencies too? Also, can self-recorded lectures too can be submitted to CEC/UGC?
Nowhere it is mentioned by UGC and CEC that EMMRC is compulsory to be roped in. But I was having preference because of the kind of expertise that these agencies are having, the kind of cameras and equipment, editing tables, softwares, and more importantly, the quality of people there, because they are having persons of more than 30 years of experience in this field only. And so they are committed people for this. But even, there is no such binding from UGC or MHRD. Even if you want to go to any private player, then you have to keep in mind few things, that the quality of your output must be of very good quality, and it should be acceptable acceptable by the funding agency. So that is how we have to be very careful and don't take it in a very shabby manner, and don't do it yourself with your mobile camera or something like that. Do it in a professional. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. We have Professor Dr. Divya Kirti Gupta with us. We will just enable the setting. Ma'am, you can unmute yourself and ask the question directly.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
So my question is very specific. That in case some other agency asks you to record online session for them, or conduct a course for them, which is like 20 sessions, and they are paying to you, but you don't want to inform your
university. Ma'am, please, can you be a bit louder, please?
Yeah, the question is, am I audible now?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So if some agency asks me to record 20 hour sessions and I don't have the support from the university, or I don't have access, easy access to the EMRC that you have said, how feasible it would be for me to record these 20 sessions?
EMRC access is not there, then I was answering to Ashish that you have to catch hold of some really professional private agencies which are having proper studio and all, and then you can approach them, and you can you will have to pay from the honorarium that you are getting from that agency. What I am telling you, and what I have emphasized earlier also, that if it is supported or funded or sponsored by UGC MHRD, then API sports will be allowed. Otherwise, if you are doing it for any private agency forum, then you can do it for your own development and for benefiting group of students. But API scores will not be allowed in that case. And yes, as I said, that recording has to be of good quality, and you can go ahead with that.
Okay.
And you can check with Coursera also. They may have some accredited such institutions in large cities like Hyderabad, Bangalore. You are from Hyderabad,
yes.
And so you can check from them that whether they are having any such accredited agency in Hyderabad for helping you out there.
Okay, thank you, sir.
We will take another question from the chat box. In the meanwhile, participants can raise their hand for asking questions or clearing their queries. Professor Manish Kumar says, how self-finance institutions implement MOOC in practice?
Implementing MOOC is not a problem, because you can encourage your students to join SWIM platform, NPTEL, or whatever appropriate platforms. And even if for their personality development, you can make a batches of your students and enroll them. Mass enrollment can be there for Coursera programs and all. That part is okay. But if you are academician working for any such self-financed institute, then I'm sorry that the UGC MHRD funding is available for 2F12B institutions only. There also you will have one more avenue, that if in your vicinity, in your neighborhood, in your network, if any senior professor of such institution which is recognized by UGC MHRD, if they are already in the process of getting awarded or already having a MOOC program, you can offer your services and associate with them. So that way I think that you will be given API scores also for that. And if you want to go alone, do it alone, then you may have to approach these private agencies like Coursera and all, which answer I had given to other previous participants also. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Now we have the
last one or two questions before we wind up.
Yes, sir. We have last question. If you permit, we can proceed with the last question, sir.
Yes, please.
Okay, sir. There is a professor, he says, how MOOCs will help students who don't have internet facility?
That is the issue. The professor who is asking the question also knows the answer as well, that we cannot help such kind of student groups. And I was reading somewhere that there will be the haves and have-nots will be redefined in future. Haves are those who are having good smartphone and good internet connection and all. Have-nots are those who are deprived from these. I want to share with Professor my own personal experience, that I was invited by Sri Lanka government to give training to the young teachers in the University of Peradeniya in Sri Lanka. And I was there for a week, and I gave them training in this online education and MOOC training and all. there, the same question was asked to me that our students are living in remote areas of Sri Lanka and they are not having access to these kind of internet and also what is the solution? Because they were offering the online program and they had to reach somehow the students, and I told them that you will have to go for two, three things, that online real-time lectures are ruled out. What you can do is that develop your videos and then develop your drop boxes and make use of cloud and drive and somehow give them access. Or alternatively, you can develop your print material that also in the DVD form and then your videos also. I suggested to them that you make not 25, 30 minutes video. You make 5, 7, 8, 10, up to 10 minutes video, which can be easily transmitted also over email and WhatsApp and all. So these are the solutions for those students who are having less internet connection. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for such a nice session and such an informative session. This is very clear by the streams of the messages that we can see in the chat box. People are complimenting more rather than the queries. I had to find in between so many compliments that, okay, which one is the question? So it was very informative one. And we are seeing that, yes, MOOCs are now in trend. And in our college also, our director, sir, Professor Dr. Bhavesh Kumar Chauhan, sir, he has been motivating all the faculty members of DBD and IBM, might be the MBA faculty or DBD, BTEC faculty members also to start recording lectures for MOOC. We have a separate lecture room also in our college. And from your session, we have imbibed a lot many things. And I'm sure many of us are going to take a step forward in this path. And now I would like to request our director, sir, to kindly grace us with few of his words. Director, sir, the stage is all yours.
Thank you, Professor Priyanka Singh, and organizing committee key member. And I welcome on behalf of the Institute, Professor Dr. Karnesh Saxena, who has such a rich experience. He has guided so many scholars, you know, so many PhD. He has been associated with many universities, and now he is heading the CBC of Udaipur University as a director. So obviously, as I could see in last 40 minutes, though I had parallel engagements, but I was hooked to the session and I couldn't move out. And it was definitely a very informative session, because he was all the time reflecting upon his experience. And when you talk from your experience, it gives a different kind of conviction. And that is why they were more compliment than the question, because the things were discussed in such a detail that, you know, it was not leaving a scope for any doubt or much intense discussion. I'm sure it must really inspire many, like Professor Priyanka Singh. She very candidly admitted for the MOOC courses. Sir, for the knowledge of audience and particularly to the knowledge of Professor Dr. Karnesh Saxena ji, and more than one and a half dozen teachers, they recently in last 15 days recorded for MOOC courses, which will be telecasted on Doordarshan, means Swayam Prabha channel from DBD and ITM. So that was really we arranged the session almost 6 months back for all the faculty as a group, where advisor who had been at helm of affair recording MOOC courses, he really called upon. But maybe at that time, because I personally believe that there is a hesitation of unknown, a fear of unknown, as Professor Karnesh ji also explained through his own experience, that in initial few minutes his hands were shivering and there were a lot of vibrations, but within couple of minutes he was normal. So I realized that despite such an intense call by that person who called here, I persuaded him to come here, and then he gave a session for almost 50 minutes, and he almost pleaded to really come out. But only 3 or 4 person eventually converted into the result at that point of time, including the director. Okay, but now, thanks to the COVID-19, in a different sense, of course, we are struggling with COVID-19. But now when I made a second call, obviously, officially, more than one and a half dozen professors immediately came back, and now they have recorded for MOOC courses to to be aired on a Doordarshan. So this community is really spreading, and I see a very important contribution by Professor Dr. Karnesh Saxena ji, not only in this time but in the pre-era also, because he's the right person to really talk about the positive part of this. So I thank on behalf of the management of Babu Banarsi Das National Institute of Technology Management, Lucknow, as well as Dr. Khilesh Das Gupta Institute of Technology and Management, New Delhi, and as well as on behalf of all the attendees of this international webinar. And I'm really thankful for this such an informative session, such a useful and meaningful session, which will have its own, rich benefits for all the faculty members who have attended this. Thank you once again. Thank you, sir. And I thank organizing committee, the Professor Priyanka and Professor Dr. Shivangi, and all the key team members, Ishita, Divyanshu, and all other members who are working day and night to really make it a real show so that all persons get benefited. Thank you once again. And over to the anchor.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for your valuable time. Thank you, sir. Dr. Shivangi, would you like to add a few lines? Dr. Shivangi?
I want to thank Dr. Chauhan for kind words.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much, sir. Me and Dr. Shivangi feel so blessed and so lucky that we are having, we can attend your session the second time. The first time we met in Central University of Rajasthan. And as I said, courtesy Corona, COVID-19, we can have you with us in virtual form. So thank you, sir, for managing to take out time from your busy schedule. Thank you so much. Thank you, the management of the college, the chairperson, ma'am, director, sir, HOD, sir, for all the support, all the participants. And dear participants, I'll again make the announcement that we'll be uploading the link for the assignment, quiz, and feedback. Kindly submit those things. And now, yes, I will repeat that 40% criteria is mandatory for successful completion of the FDP, and 80% attendance is mandatory. So kindly please keep these things in mind. And yes, I know you people are very patient. Thank you. And now I'll ask Ishita to take things forward. Ishita, please, the stage is yours.
Thank you so much, ma'am. First of all, I would like to thank our honorable guest, Professor Dr. Karnesh Saxena, sir, for giving us such an informative session, really talking about all the practical methods to improvise our teaching and giving proper sequencing to design the MOOCs, and how it is very important that we work in teams so that they not only help us in designing but also delivering those MOOCs. And above all, thank you so much, sir, for sharing your experiences with us. It is very valuable to us. And again, I would express my heartfelt thanks to you, sir. And I would also like to thank our chief patron, Mrs. Alka Das Gupta, ma'am, chairperson, BBD Group of Education, the patrons, Professor Dr. Bhavesh Kumar Chauhan, sir, director, BBD and ITM Lucknow, Professor Dr. Sanjay Kumar, sir, director, Dr. AG ITM New Delhi, the advisory committee, which includes Mr. Vinay Kumar Yadav, sir, Ms. Swati Khanna, ma'am, and Mr. Asim Sahore, sir, the organizing committee, including Dr. Shivangi Tiwari, ma'am, Ms. Priyanka Singh, ma'am, and the co-coordinators of the program, Ms. Pooja Garg, ma'am, and Ms. Twinkle Arora, ma'am. I would also like to thank student coordinators, Mr. Divyanshu Singh, student president, BBD and ITM, Mr. Ayush Agarwal, student MBA first year, and Mr. Aaron Agrahari, student MBA first year, for assisting us throughout the program. This session was filled with great learnings and has been an enriching experience for all the participants. And thank you, everyone, for making it possible. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you all.
Thank you so much, Ishita. Thank you, everyone. And my warmest regards and thanks from my side and from Dr. Shivangi's side. She has some network issues, but sir, she is expressing all her gratitude to you. And thank you, participants, and thank you, student coordinators. Sir, with your permission, we can proceed to wind it up.
Yeah, sure.
Please.
Thank you. Divyanshu, please, you can go ahead with winding it up.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
So, with your permission, I'm ending this meeting, ma'am.
Yes, sir. Yes, Divyanshu, please go ahead.